Hello and welcome to another episode of 420 grams here on newsclick.in. Garmi ka mausam hai and if you live in India, you must be feeling the heat like we are. In fact, aajkal itni news, itni khabrein chal rahi hai hamare channel pe, dusre channel mein, pure desh mein ki kapde badalne ka bhi time nahi mila hai. Agar aap dekh rahe hain show ko, to pichli baar humne yehi kapde pehne hue the. But aisa hai ki football ki duniya mein bhi kafi news aa raha hai, flying in thick and fast. We have a new technical director for the Indian football team, or for Indian football. Hmm. And we now possibly have a new coach for the men's national team. Igor Stimac's name has been recommended by the All India Football Federation's technical committee to the executive committee for approval. He is the front runner and likely to be approved within the next 48 hours. Arjun Pandit is on the show as usual. Vaibhav Raghunandan is joining in as our Croatia expert. And so let's get straight into it. Hmm. Who is Igor Stimac and why is this a good decision for Indian football?
See, I don't know if it's a good decision or a bad decision. That only time will tell, and what kind of ethos he puts on the team and the way he moves the team forward. But I can tell you of what went down in that interview, where the four candidates were being interviewed by the technical committee. And as far as Mr. Stimac is concerned, he was the last of the four, though the only one that made his way to India. Personal appearance. So he wasn't on Skype, so there was no lag issue, Wi-Fi issue, whatever. Yes. You know, these small things happen in our country, man.
Like we had in studio for the last hour and a half.
Exactly. It took us about an hour and a half to get this show going, courtesy of bad Wi-Fi and so on and so forth. So when, as soon as Igor Stimac came on, he straight away, when he met the technical committee and when they were asking him, what do you know about Indian football? He said, look, I think you've got a good bunch of players. Okay, he said, I think you've got a good bunch of players. Took about 7-8 Indian players' names. Gurpreet Singh Sandhu, Udanta, Sandesh Jhingan, Chhetri, Vineet Rai. Ha ha, for all of you who questioned me when I put Vineet Rai in my team of the season. Hmm. Igor Stimac took his name as well. And this really caught the technical committee by surprise, and in a good way. You know, they were like, wow, ye toh hume pata hi nahi tha. Because pichle teen jo kiye the, unme se kisi ne naam maam aise liye nahi. Even though Albert Roca knew everyone. Hmm. But for a guy who has never been a part of Indian football, who's coming into India for the very first time, they were taken aback and they kind of got the feeling that he's done his homework and come. He in fact even said that Anas is a very good defender. Sadly, he is retired, but don't worry, we have enough backup now to cover that position, right? Then he went on to say, look, I've been following what the Indian team has done. He said, I saw what they did at the Asian Cup. I thought the way they played versus Thailand, that is the way they need to be playing, which is solidity in defense, quick transition, quick passing, and make your way to goal. Hmm. Not possession, not holding the ball, not playing tiki-taka or whatever it is that we've been talking about. Even we've been talking about it. Hmm. Good, solid shape, change, transition, win the ball, and boom forward with 4 or 5 players. Quick passes, not more than 1-2 touches, like they did in Thailand second half, and move forward. He said in UAE and Bahrain, UAE, you guys should have scored 4 or 5 goals. That's the obvious. I think all of us saw that game. So that was pretty obvious. He said, in the Bahrain game and UAE, probably you needed a different way of approaching it. In the sense, someone need to tell them that what you're doing right now, tweak it a little bit. Mm. You know, tweak it a little bit that so that the ball crosses the line. So that is what he said. So he said, needed to think differently in certain important situations in the UAE and Bahrain game. Then, if you look at Igor Stimac's record, his record has not been very great. If you look at success rate and success percentage, it's close to about 20-25%, which
even,
is nothing great.
In fact, even when he was Croatia manager, when he was looking at the national team, that was the hardest or the most sort of laborious qualification process for the World Cup that they went through.
But they qualified.
But they qualified.
They still qualified.
They qualified, yeah.
But he oversaw at least 90% of the qualification, my point being.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Irrespective of where you were. So then to that question that was posed at him, he said, look, a majority of my club career, I have worked with clubs which are relegation threatened. Mm. And I have saved them from relegation. Mm. So, point being that when you're working with relegation clubs, of course, your loss column is going to be much more than your win column. Yeah. But when you save a relegation club with the kind of quality you have in your team, with the kind of players you have in your team, the mentality of not always winning all the time, that in itself is something I feel is something can be picked up and put into the Indian team. Because we are not the big boys in the world of football, no. Nor are we the big boys in Asia, but we achieve to be there, or rather we aim to be there, right? So that was one of his answers for when questioned about his success rate. Now, the technical committee said, apart from that, he spoke very well, came across as someone who's very media friendly, and came across as a pleasant personality, to which they felt that finally, you might have a coach who can do his bit to market Indian football. Mm. Because I think all of us are working in the media, all three of us have done this, that the last coach, Stephen Constantine, for whatever he may have done for the Indian team, and a lot of it has been positive to bringing us where we are and what we did at the Asian Cup, you can take nothing away from it. He was not the most media-friendly person, in a sense. Mm. So they felt...
Well, like, I mean, I don't know. He was always pretty friendly with us. We did a few interviews and stuff.
Yeah.
He did give time. I think the issue with this media friendliness and all these things, of course, we'll see how they develop.
No, media.
Because I think Stimac might have also a little bit of a googly in there, because I don't think he will take, like, the great thing, I think, how this is a step forward, is that here is a guy who has pedigree both as a player
and as a coach.
As well as a coach, right? He's part of that fabled golden generation of Croatian football.
1998.
We talk about and remember so fondly. He's a teammate of Davor Šuker. They won the under-20 FIFA World Cup
in 1987. Yeah. Yugoslavia team.
Yeah, and he had a long stint with the national team and was part of the squad that won, that finished third at the World Cup in 98. So, I mean, this is not a small thing for Indian football to have that level of a person at the helm of things who has not just played or taken a team to a World Cup, but he's actually been in it right till the thick end of it.
That was one of the points the technical committee also felt, is that you have someone, because if you remember when we went to AIFF House to do our little stakeout to find out who the technical director will be, it was categorically told to us by everyone we met over there that we want to get someone who can take Indian football to the next level, right? Now, beyond that, some of the points he made to the technical committee were that age group teams, all your under-15s, under-16s, under-18s, every 2-3 months or whenever when you can on a regular basis, should be mingling with the senior team, whether it be on the field, whether it be off the field. So, say some, you know, you have this one boy who's playing really well in the under-16, give them the opportunity to hang out with a Sunil Chhetri, to watch him train and to just chill with them off the field and on the field. Right? Now, the one line that really worked in his favour, and I think sort of tells you why the technical committee went with him, because when you're part of the Indian job, and while it might look like a plus job that you're the, you know, you're the head coach of a country, as far as football, head coach of a country for football is concerned, he said, in adversity also you can survive towards success, because being the head coach of a national team here doesn't mean you're guaranteed to a proper training facility all the time, as we know. Being the head coach of a national team doesn't mean you're guaranteed to your players coming at you when you want them. So maybe if you have a 4-day camp, it might just get reduced to a 2-day camp. So point being, a lot of curveballs and so on will be thrown at you during your tenure.
Yeah.
And you need to take that in your stride and move on. It can't just be, you know, since I am the coach, why is this not being coming my way? Why is that not being done? Because you need to realize the realities of Indian football are very different. Football is not our number one or top priority as far as sports is concerned. Now, they were unanimous in their decision that Stimac is the guy going forward, as has come out in the press as well. Just a couple of things. They were asked, now the King's Cup is the first real assignment for the national team, which is in June, when India goes to Thailand to play in that four-nation tournament. So he said, I already have a 36-player list ready. Which is, again, these guys were like, wow, ye kahan se ho gaya, huh? So 36-player list he already has ready. And he's saying, I will not change anything in the team right now. It would be stupid. Could just come in and start, you know, chopping, changing whatever I want to do. I will find what is our biggest strength and then try developing a style based on that. Right?
So going back to that technical committee meeting that we had sort of tried to sneak into, the members of the technical committee were speaking of exactly this, that whoever comes in as coach should look at the existing pool of players and then make a game plan.
Yeah, it shouldn't be that I'll come and I'll scout everyone. Ab main isko dhundunga, usko dhundunga. You know, because there's a lot of years of work that has gone behind getting this pool of players together and who have been together. And India, to be fair, were the second youngest team at the Asian Cup, 25. So you must take that as a major advantage moving forward to the 2023 Asian Cup.
Yeah.
Right? So a 10-day camp is what he's asking for prior to the King's Cup.
Which should be doable because there's no season.
There's no football, right? Then he wants two friendlies. And in those two friendlies, he will judge the team and see what's happening, what's not happening, right? In all likelihood, he will be given a three-year term, right? So that means 2022 tak. So in the sense, they're going to basically review where he stands 1 year before the Asian Cup. Yeah. And the technical director has also been given a three-year term. So both of them will work side to side. And his major aim should be to qualify for the 2023 Asian Cup again, which shouldn't be a problem. But you never know, because world football moves at a rapid pace, man. And so other teams can easily play catch-up or whatever. If you get lazy, you know, you might just fall back. And then, of course, try doing something which you haven't done much in the group stage. I mean, to say that to qualify from the group stages, badi dur ki baat hai. Qualify for the Asian Cup and then move forward. Yeah.
Right. So for those of you watching, first, you must note this, huh? 5 minutes uncut, dhada dhada baat ki hai bhai ne. Theek hai? Aise hi karte hai TV.
Ye hui na baat. Lage rao.
So what we'll do now is we'll very quickly we'll bring you in, Vaibhav, just another minute or so to do a quick roundup of the other people who were in the fray and how their interview processes went, and then we'll move on from there into the Croatia bit of the conversation in terms of the philosophy and what's happening with the local FA and the issues there, which I want to bring up because it probably feeds into the larger connection that is trying to be established between whatever systems are trying to be put in place. So there was Lee Myung-Sun from South Korea.
Yeah.
There was Hakan Eriksson of Sweden.
Yeah.
And Albert Roca of Spain and Bangalore FC. In the running along with Mr. Stimac.
So the first guy to be interviewed was Lee Myung-Sun, right? And he came across as a very sound guy, only 41 years of age, and he looked extremely good, looked extremely sharp. You know, when you're talking to someone in an interview, body language, everything is taken into account. Now, he had an interpreter and with him, because English was a bit of a problem. So he also said, look, defensively, my aim is India needs to be very strong defensively. Transition, counter-attack, quick passing, move your way ahead. So if basically that style of play, three of the four wanted that style of play only. Okay. Saying that, keeping in mind the realities of Indian football, ye hai hamara style of
Mr.
play.
Mr. Roca wanted to mix it up a bit, huh?
Yeah, we'll get to it in a bit. But the only issue with him was where the TC thought, technical committee thought, communication might be a bit of an issue because he wanted to get his own interpreter and he wanted to get one member of his support staff with him from Korea. And the rest he would work with, of course, the Indian support staff given to him. So communication was the major issue, which is why they did not
staff member, which becomes an issue, I guess, because we have a fixed budget because FIFA, from their development funds, gives us about $250,000 per year to pay our national team coach. And so having an extra player coming in who's also an extra staff member coming in who's also an expat, you also have to pay in dollars. It becomes an issue, even if though that salary might have been in the range of $50,000-$60,000. Is money that we apparently don't have. It's unfortunate that these are issues because I think some level of support staff is important to help a coach also fit into a new role. But at the same time, it is possible that having guys like Venki and the existing support staff,
I think you should carry them forward,
They should definitely be
because
carried
they've
forward.
They've seen the growth of the team.
Yeah, but there's nothing stopping a national team from having two assistant coaches.
Fair enough. Yeah.
It's not it shouldn't be a thing either way. But whatever. Anyway, now the decision is done. So.
Done is done. So second man on the Skype interview was Albert Roca. Everyone knows him, of course. Everyone watching knows him. So first question straight away that was thrown at him was that, listen, all that you've achieved with Bengaluru, how will you manage that with the national team? Because with Bengaluru, let's not forget, you also had 5-6 foreign players with you. Now you remove those 5-6 foreign players. Are you going to continue doing the same style and the style of play that you were adopting with Bengaluru? To which his answer was, look, I feel Indian players technically are very sound. I think that style of play can easily be adopted moving forward. Give me time with the players and I will work with the players and make them even better. Right? So now when the technical director spoke to him, a lot of Roca's questioning and interview came across as I. So, I will do this, I will take the team forward, I will put this. So, you know, it wasn't a V, right? At the end of the day, when you're coming to be a coach, you're being the coach of a national team, you're part of an association, so it's V. It's, you know, they were looking at that. But here it came across as, I will do this, I will do that. And so, somewhere, seemed a little selfish in approach, right? Seemed a little selfish in approach. And when he was asked, look, he said, I want to get one support staff of mine so that I can trust one guy. Which again came across as a little selfish, saying that I don't trust the Indian support staff, right? When they were said, look, why not continue with the Indian support staff? He said, look, I can of course move forward with the Indian support staff, but I need to have one guy on that team who I trust. Mera banda jo hai, right? So then he was asked, where will you stay? So he said, I will only stay in Mumbai or Goa. I won't stay in Delhi owing to the pollution. Again, so it came across as a little, didn't come across as flexible.
That doesn't seem unreasonable. I want to stay in Goa.
I agree with that. No, I mean, even that, Delhi's got a pollution scene and all, man. The only thing is proximity to Federation, right? How often will you...
Yeah, you can't be like in the job and not have that once in a while come and see your team that is putting everything together for you, meet the guys who are behind the scenes planning stuff, who are executing the planning, who are actually doing the work, putting in the data, tabulating how players are going, looking at age group competitions.
Yeah.
If you completely remove yourself from that, now the coach has an office at the All India Football Federation, and I think it's very important for not just the coach, but even people who are playing in the national team to engage with the federation, especially senior players in the senior team, give them feedback, know the guys who are working hard to put together whatever it is that Indian football now receives. So,
to be fair, this way you're staying in this day and age, it's a non-issue.
It's all like a two-hour flight.
It's a bit of a non-issue. You've got Sky, Tribe, everything on you. So I think that's a bit of a non-issue. But
the point here was, for me, was that even when they were looking at a technical director, Scott was in the mix. Scott O'Donnell, who had been technical director for India earlier and put together that plan and roadmap and such like. The technical committee seemed to have moved away from people who have preconceived notions or have done work in India, which I think is a great step forward.
Because I agree.
We have not had such magnificent people coming in and working in India. I think who we got to come in was a mix of availability, opportunity and budgets, and it was kind of all put together on an ad hoc basis. This time there seems to be a little bit of divergence ki hum soch ke ja rahe hain usme overall thoda dekh ke plan dekh ke ja rahe hain aur us hisab se aage badhenge.
In that sense the timing also has to be applauded na ki aapne pehle technical director apna chuna hai.
Bilkul.
Chunne ke baad technical director aapke interviews pe baitha hai and he sat with the four people you shortlisted and then he's had his say. And your technical director has come because he has certain backing in world football.
Yeah.
And he's come to take you to a certain level, right? So that way it should be applauded. But the main thing with Roka was this, that you will not have the same support system, the same kind of support that you were given when you were Bengaluru coach, right? Because you had everything in place. You had your foreigners, you had your training sessions, you had your facilities and everything that was given. For as far as the national team is concerned, of course, you will be given the best of stuff. But there will be days when you will not be given it, where it might not work out.
Yeah, I got to say also, like it does at some level become a question of optics or perception or whatever you want to call it. You can't keep bringing in national team head coaches because some people have good relationships with them. There's an inherent bias in that being your method of employing people or selecting people for the job. I'm not necessarily saying it's nepotism. But there's definitely a connection between, like, when Constantine came back the second time. At that time, the technical committee had members who were very much in favor of him returning, simply because they had a good equation and it worked, right? Now, 5 years from then, Indian football has also moved forward.
It was not that bad a move, though.
No, good move, bad move, whatever. Yeah, it worked out. To whatever extent we could have hoped, it worked out. But since then, like we're all saying, because of the ISL and things like that, Indian football has also grown. It's now available widely on the internet. Not so much excitement. But at least TV pe logon ko dekhne ko mil raha hai, sun rahe hain, players aa rahe hain. And I think quite a few of the agents and players involved also are guys who operate in Eastern Europe and stuff like that. There are many positives, you know, Eastern Europe, they are used to doing things the hard way, the scientific way, the methodical way, all of these things which this structure in India lacks. And I think that organization and stuff which both Doru Isaac and Stimac can bring to the table will be, I think it's going to be a fun couple of years, definitely, and I hope.
I think there's also, like, I think there's, like, I've always had this little thing about a guy, a coach at the club level is very different from the coach at a national level, simply because the amount of time they spend with the team. So while, I mean, I cannot, we cannot deny Roca's influence on Bengaluru, he also spent a lot of time with the team, which he may not get to spend with the Indian national team. So influencing their style of play, changing the perception of players and making them inculcate his style of play, all that is like too much to ask for from a national team, perhaps.
Yeah, yeah. Fair enough. I mean, if he would have made the argument that I'll work with the national team players and make them better, I'll just say, bro, you have them for 5 days in a year. How much work are you going to do with them?
Like a national team manager is basically just doing like, wo matlab chaat masala maar raha hai aur acche se ek presentation taiyar kar raha hai. He's not a
sahi baat hai. Sahi baat hai. Mota mota kaam ISL ke teams aur unke clubs kar rahe hain jo unke saath zyada tar reh rahe hain. Just finally, ab main uske baad aur footage khaunga nahi.
वैसे हमारा time खत्म हो गया है. तो Hakan Ericksen को
Hakan Ericksen base mota mota yehi tha, very professional presentation, very professional chat, same thing, defense strong, quick passing, transition, also had experience in Sweden. The only thing that went against him was that he's worked with a lot of junior teams. So how will he be able to work with a senior player where the ego comes in, the mentality comes in, the star player? That was the main drawback as far as Hakan Ericksen, because then came Stimac. Up until then, Hakan Ericksen was the front runner.
I can imagine. I mean, he's won the Euros with Sweden.
Yeah.
The under 21 Euros, it's not a small achievement.
Yeah.
Like we're talking about the fact that the pool of Indian players is a younger and younger pool, where we were one of the youngest teams at the Asian Cup, for example. So working with the Indian senior team is almost akin to working with the under 23 team.
Yeah.
So, I mean, I don't understand the logic of how these decisions are made, but fair enough. They've made the decision, so let's get that
done,
out of the
done,
way.
Done.
Let's quickly, Weber, chat with you about the Croatia connection, what's been happening in Croatian football over the last few years since Šuker is the president of the Football Federation. So hopefully we can look forward to some kind of, these guys used to be teammates back in the day. If we can get some kind of cooperation going, and this is a country of 4 million people that just reached the finals of
I don't think Šuker and Stimac have a very good relationship.
But
right,
he's come out. He's come out in the press and he said, "Look, you're getting a very sorted guy. You're getting a solid guy."
No, of course. Why would he say otherwise? But I don't think they have like an interpersonal relationship like which is that close. Simply because I think there was a bit. They had a bit of a falling out when Stimac resigned, but he did not communicate clearly to the Croatian FA. Of course, this is all so long back that it could have all just been buried and bridge has been built over those troubled waters. But still, like, I mean, I don't know how much of an influence Croatian football will have in Indian football because they have their own problems. It's not like Croatian football bahut saaf hai, bahut achha nadi hai, wahan par sab kuch achha, bahut achhe phool ug rahe hain, waisa nahi hai. Obviously, in sab ganne paani se hi achhe-achhe players nikle hain. And those players have come out despite the fact that their system is really bad. Not because of the system itself.
आप कमल के फूल के लिए तो पिच नहीं कर रहे हैं ना?
नहीं हम कमल के फूल के लिए पिच नहीं कर रहे हैं. हम halfway through my analogy हमें लगा कि कमल के फूल के बात हो रही थी तो हमने correct किया जल्दी से.
पर आपने Stimac पे कुछ थोड़ा मसाला निकाला है. क्या है वो मसाला?
तो मसाला यही actually आपने मसाला बोल ही दिया है. वैसे almost I had spoken to a journalist who's based in Croatia. He's not a football journalist, but since we are in English, like he understands us as an English centric footballing audience, so he simplified what Stimac is for me by saying he's Sam Allardyce from Croatia.
Big Sam. Okay, fair enough.
And at one level I was like, that's perfect. Because we are the Big Sam type country. Like, हमारे पास तो ऐसे players नहीं है जो sleek footwork और stepovers और ये वो. तो हमें तो बिल्कुल ऐसा एक systematic manager चाहिए जो रगड़े लोगों को system में खेले. And again, I don't know if it was just coincidence, but you'd said that the players he mentioned, maybe it was just coincidence, but you said Gurpreet Singh Sandhu, Sandesh Jhingan, Anas, and all of them are defensive-minded players. They're all at the back end of the team. And he is that sort of manager who builds from the back. He is focused on having a very defensively solid system. In fact, during his Croatia days, this was a huge criticism because they're not like us, right? They want to play beautiful, flowing football. So in Stimac's time, the crowd numbers had dropped a huge amount in his time as coach of the Croatian national team. In fact, they recorded the lowest ever crowd for a Croatia game in his tenure when they played Belgium in Split.
But the key being that what Croatia wants from their football team, which is much more evolved from where we are as a footballing nation, as opposed to what India wants from a coach, is very, very different.
Oh yeah, of course.
Like, I mean, zameen aasman ka farak.
We also have to say that when Stimac was in charge, he did take Croatia up to number 4 in the rankings. Mm. So since we are a bit ranking obsessed, you know, maybe he'll figure something out to keep that part of the conversation happy.
On the other hand, Stimac also knows, obviously, because he comes from this Croatian system of football, and while their football may be vastly different from us, उनका सिस्टम भी हमारे तरह ही है. वहां पर भी क्लब्स बहुत गंदी तरह से चलाए जाते हैं, वहां पर भी क्लब्स में बहुत करप्शन है, वहां पर भी प्लेयर्स के साथ बहुत गंदी तरीके से ट्रीट होते हैं, एडमिनिस्ट्रेटर्स बहुत पैसे कमाते हैं, सब कुछ ये सब होता रहता है, और उस सिस्टम से ही वो भी निकल के आए हैं. सो ही अंडरस्टैंड्स पर्हैप्स हाउ इट वर्क्स,
हाउ टू नेविगेट द पॉलिटिक्स, दैट इज पर्हैप्स मोर इंपॉर्टेंट देन.
या एंड यू नो समटाइम्स हाउ टू नेविगेट द पॉलिटिक्स एंड हाउ टू सॉर्ट ऑफ यू नो मेक योर वे अराउंड दिस मडल
is
and exactly, it's not discussed enough, it's not spoken about enough. We try to concentrate too much on what's happening on the field, ki wo kya kar raha hai, but wo field 90 minutes se pehle jo 2-3 mahine ka kaam hai aur jiske beech mein se aap apni jagah bana rahe ho, naiya le ja rahe ho, all of that is very important because all of that plays into what your team eventually does in those 90 minutes. Agar aapke paas ek banda aa gaya jisne haath khade kar diye, usne kaha sir main to nahi kar paunga ye, main kaise karu, ye kya system hai, ye kya ho raha hai, then you're back in the dumps, right?
Hmm. Absolutely. So nowadays, unfortunately, the term football manager is like all-encompassing and people often confuse a manager with a coach. But at a certain point of time, a manager used to be this guy. The football manager would be the guy who will negotiate the politics. And the coach would be a different guy. He would have a set of coaches who would do the coaching aspect of the football and he would do the management aspect of the football. So it's definitely a thing.
So makes sense, yeah. Then all in all, it seems like a fairly good decision, and we also hope that thoda mupat type ka ho banda, because matlab ab kitne 4-5 saal ho gaye and we are hearing the same sort of back and forth conversations. I mean, a lot. In fact, today's news, one of the main national newspapers today has a long piece on the legacy of Stephen Constantine as India coach. He gets a lot of credit for a lot of things, and some of it he should get. But his attitude towards both the team as well as the system was like, I am India manager and this is the Indian football team and we should be getting this. Agar ye nahi hoga, toh hum nahi khelenge. Us type ka kuch scene gradually ban gaya tha. When the guy becomes as big or bigger than the cause that he's supposed to manage.
Agreed.
I think this guy will have infinitely more experience in dealing with those kind of situations and dealing with people who are heading things also.
Definitely. He's also like, there's a lovely little story that I had heard about him from his playing days, which is that in the last few weeks that Yugoslavia existed, his team, Hajduk Split, were playing Red Star Belgrade for the Yugoslav Cup. So in that time, tensions were really high. Like, I mean, obviously, because of the separationist movements, all kinds of violence. So apparently, only 2 Split supporters traveled to Belgrade to watch their team in the final. And of course, our man was part of the Split team. And then part of the Red Star Belgrade team was Sinsa Mihajlovic, who is obviously another legend madman. Bilkul, unka bhi temper waise hi bhadakta hai. So both of them had a major fight very early in the match, got red cards and got sent off, and then Split won the game and came back. So he's not going to be like a very, very relaxed attitude wala manager, that can be guaranteed.
Looking forward to some punch-ups then. It might not be a lovely story, but it'll be a fun story anyway. On that note, I think we've gone
Let's not annoy him much.
We'll try.
Can I send out a message to the All India Football Federation?
Absolutely.
Let us interview him, man.
Please.
One on one.
Two on one. Three on one, maybe.
Three on one. We'd love to get the thoughts of the national
team. I
think we've warranted it a little bit because we regularly apne aapko dedicate kar rahe hain towards Indian football on a weekly basis. And we live in Delhi. So our ticket wicket bhi nahi lagegi. Itna kuch problem hai nahi. So,
we've gone, I think, 10 minutes over our scheduled time of 15.
As always.
But I think you'll let us go, give us a pass this time because it is something that we've been dying to talk about. And now that we finally have some juice, we thought we'd let it out in one shot. I'll leave you with this great thought from Mr. Butler of The Guardian, which Weber pulled up yesterday on the minute by minute. I'm sure you've all been watching what's been happening in Europe. Four English teams are in the finals of both the big European competitions. So at the 75 minute, Mr. Butler said this. So Man City will win the league. Liverpool play Spurs for the Champions League. Chelsea play Arsenal for Europa. And Man United have a wonderful new documentary to watch about the 99 season. all you United fans, go watch some other show. The rest of you guys, please keep tuning in. Thanks for watching. See you next week.